da 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 hey da 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 da. It's the very curious news from around the globe with the amazing Cornelio. Very curious news item number one. Wayne Rooney's wife shows excellent detective skills as she figures out that Jamie Vardy's wife has been leaking personal stories about the Rooney family to The Sun, and Jamie Vardy's wife has denied it, and everyone can't stop talking about it online, and gossip, 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 ooh, ooh, ooh. And do you know what I have to say to all this? Who gives a shit? Very curious news item, number two. I'm finally chiming in on the Christian Pulisic situation at Chelsea. You know the part where American fans in particular are upset because he's not playing much with the Blues, but I believe there are a couple of issues at play here. One, he got signed under one manager, Maurizio Sarri, but he left, and now Chelsea have a new one in Frank Lampard, so the plans for Pulisic's role within the team could have changed. Two, though with number one being said, I remember Sarri being somewhat surprised that they signed Pulisic, and it didn't seem like he really knew much about him, which proves the point I made in a video a while back about this purely being a marketing move. Because Pulisic is arguably the best player on the US men's national team, and he's a Nike athlete, and Chelsea's a Nike team, so Nike probably paid for some of his transfer fee since it would expand Chelsea's reach and sell a lot of Chelsea Nike kits in the biggest market in the world. But the American fans are becoming more savvy, and they're not just gonna buy his jersey unless he actually plays. And he did, for a little bit, to start the season, but since then, the English manager is using his very talented English players in the starting 11 like Mason Mount, or more experienced players like Willian and Pedro instead, which might feel unfair at times since Pulisic has made a difference when he comes onto the field, but let me tell you how you fight unfairness. Play better. Every single day, in training, in games, it doesn't matter, play better. And this goes for everyone who is a player right now, not just Pulisic. If you want to get into the starting 11, play better than everyone else on the team. And when you're not in the starting 11, which is going to give you the impulse to complain or have shitty body language, which makes it clear that you're unhappy, shut your mouth, stop feeling sorry for yourself, be a good professional, and then when your opportunity comes, play better. Because no one owes you anything. Frank Lampard doesn't owe Christian Pulisic a thing. If Christian Pulisic was undeniably the better player at every training and in every game, he would be playing. It's that simple. If some days he's good and some days he's not, and it feels even between him and his competition, then that gives the manager, Frank Lampard in this case, a chance to go with his favorites. And after the year that Frank Lampard spent with Mason Mount last season with Derby, of course Mason Mount is gonna be Frank Lampard's favorite. He knows him. He trusts him. Frankly, I love that Pulisic is going through this because it's gonna make him tougher. And that mental strength is gonna serve him well both on and off the field throughout his career. But now he just has to figure out how to play better, consistently. Very curious news item, number three. Bayern Munich's Thomas Müller is upset that he's not playing more this season. Yes, according to reports, Thomas Müller says he has too much ambition to be a bench player, and he's reportedly going to ask Bayern to sell him in January. To which I have to say, welcome to the wrong side of 30 years old, Thomas, because now they have a 27-year-old, which is considered the prime age for a professional athlete, who can do the job instead. And his name is Philippe Coutinho. Which is crazy to think about, right? A man who has never played for another club in his whole life. He's played 325 games with Bayern's first team. He's won every single trophy imaginable for both club and country, including scoring 10 World Cup goals for Germany. And yet he's hit that point in his career where he's not the guy anymore. And having gone through that myself on a much, much smaller scale, of course, it's hard. It's really hard, actually, because you have to accept that everyone is replaceable, even yourself. Very curious news, Adam. Number four, would you want to manage a top club? Do you have the courage and mental fortitude to handle the pressure? I mention this because 6 months ago, yes, only 6 months ago, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer went to Paris and beat PSG in the Champions League, which was the culmination of a few terrific months for him in charge of Manchester United, which then led to him being touted as their Lord and Savior, as the man that would restore the club to its former glory, and now look at him. Currently in 12th place after 8 games, and this was after a lackluster transfer window from an attacking perspective, where he didn't replace Romelu Lukaku, the only true number 9 he had, and it shows. Which reminds me of another club, AC Milan, who are also desperately seeking to regain their former glory as one of the best clubs in Europe, but they can't get out of their own way either, because they just fired their 8th coach in the last 5 years. Yes, their 8th coach in the last 5 years just yesterday. Which is embarrassing because a club of Milan's stature needs to be cool and calm and collected in tough situations. And instead, they have the same sense of entitlement that I was talking about earlier. Oh, we're AC Milan. We're supposed to be good because look at what we've done in the past. Well, another fun fact for you, not only does no one owe you anything, the past doesn't either. You still have to go out and prove yourself every single day. So AC Milan, play better, manage better, be better. And in your case in particular, be patient. Acting rashly all the time when things don't immediately change for the better is not a good look. And speaking of patience, let's talk about a club that does have that, Tottenham. And in particular, their manager Mauricio Pochettino, who due to this patience and a well thought out plan to build a team, they enjoyed incredible success last season, but now they kind of suck. Having won only 3 times in 11 games in all competitions this season, which includes losing to a fourth division club in the third round of the Carabao Cup. You guys remember that? Probably not, because they gave up 7 goals to Bayern at home in the Champions League. That's probably a little bit more fresh for your memory. And then they lost to Brighton this past weekend 3-0, and that was all in the last 3 weeks alone. Which makes me think that Pochettino should have got out at the end of last season because he took the team as far as it could with this particular group of players. Especially given the quality of Liverpool and Man City, he's probably not gonna win the league anytime soon or ever. So I think he just needed to recognize the reality of his situation and to get a new challenge, as do some of his players, frankly, because everyone just seems so antsy there, ready to do something different. Anyway, I wanted to give you a few examples of teams that don't have patience, teams that are kind of in the middle, and teams that do have patience and how it still can be a real disaster in all different ways. So this is me getting back to my original question. Do you think you can handle the hot seat, the pressure, the expectations, managing the egos in the locker room and the bigger egos on the board, the media spotlight, always saying the right thing at the right time? I'm not so sure that you can. Very curious news item. Number 5, Mustafi is a human being. After a very candid interview with Der Spiegel, I think that's how you say it, where he addressed how he's essentially become a meme, Mustafi talked about how he's become a target for abuse even when he's not playing, where he gets blamed for Arsenal's losses even when he's not on the field, and how that's impacted him personally and his family overall, and his words and what he said bumps me out. As someone who's been a player like him once, minus the winning a World Cup part, you don't have to remind me. Constant negativity can wear you and a team down, so sometimes I wonder if social media actually hurts clubs and their players. Like the bullshit racist comments we see if a player of color misses a chance. So I wish you couldn't be anonymous on social media. I wish you had to be exactly who you are so that everyone could see who said what. I think that would help. Anyway, this news item was for me and me only because I promised to be a little easier on Mustafi. And all right, that's it. That's all I got. So give me your thoughts down below. I want to hear from you. Later.